For 1100 years I have fought, and I have seen the darkness in our galaxy. I have seen the vileness of the alien and the heresy of the mutant. I have witnessed the sin of possession. I have seen all the evil that a galaxy harbors, and I have slain all whose presence defiles the Emperor. I have seen what you will see. I have fought what you must fight, and I have slain what you must slay. So fear not, and be proud, for we are the sons of Sanguinius, the protectors of mankind. Aye, we are indeed the angels of death.
The Adeptus Astartes are the blade against the most terrible creatures of the void. Molded in the noble image of their gene sires, the Primarchs, each angel of death exhibits a fragment of their noble bearing and might. And among these noble warriors, their chapter masters are the pinnacle of the pursuit to embody their example, with many revered as among the most legendary heroes of the Imperium. Yet one among them has served his chapter for over a millennia, free from the constraints of a dreadnought sarcophagus, yet burdened by age and untold sacrifices. The Lord of Angels and Commander of Imperium Nihilus, Luis Dante. The origins of the revered commander of the Blood Angels is that of a humble and wise boy beyond his years, born within the cradle of the great angel's homeworld. Born during 447.M40, the child of the second moon of Baal Secundus would find his early years characterized by malnutrition, radiation, and struggle. His circumstance stunting his growth, the small boy of the Salt Clans traveled the dried up seas of his celestial body's now desert sands and harvested salt for trade. Traveling from settlement to settlement within the borders of the salt deserts, the boy known as Luis had known his mother only 7 cycles before her death, and so relied solely on his father, Arrhaeus. Danger was ever present during his youth, for human raiders and wild beasts regularly hounded the salt clans of Baal Secundus, with few members of the clans exceeding the age of 30. Imbued with the virtue of compassion, Luis from the start of his life had always sought to aid his peers and never wasted his potential for good. Yet among his most lofty dreams, one above all loomed large in his thoughts, the angelic host. Near deific beings to the clans of Baal Secundus, these towering figures clad in red and gold regularly recruited aspirants into their order from the stock of his people, and as such, Luis resolved to one day become an angel of death. His father forbidding him to attempt the trials of the Astartes, Arrhaeus would not allow for his last blood relative to die needlessly at the altar of glory. Undeterred by his father's wishes, Luis ventured to the cliff face of Angel's Fall in secret in order to become an aspirant of the Crimson Angels. Traversing the perilous Great Salt Wastes alone, Luis endured the immense thirst that parched his throat, and in his moment of greatest suffering was visited by a golden figure of light. The Sanguinor, ancient protector of the Blood Angels chapter, looked down upon Luis and saw within him great potential, with such an instance the first of many which the two would share. Leading him to the mummified corpse of an unfortunate traveler who had long ago died from his own failed venture, Luis found intact water flasks which would prove crucial in sustaining his dehydrated body. Reaching the site where Sanguinius had first been found as a child by the natives of Baal Secundus, within the shadow of Angel's Fall, Luis began his trials at the place of challenge. Among the 500 assembled aspirants of the Blood, Dante showed no visible signs of strength, athleticism, or resilience. Boys of much taller profile looked down upon the emaciated boy among their ranks and saw only weakness in his form. Yet within the eyes of the son of Arrhaeus, a fierce determination burned. Surviving the winnowing laid forth by the Blood Angels' recruiters, Chapter Malafael inducted Luis to serve under the charge of Sanguinary Priest a raison. Succeeding in the trial of war, Luis led a band of his peers to victory against their rival band of aspirants. Disgusted by the bloodshed required to succeed in his trial, such empathy would serve Luis well during his trial of Horus. Refusing to slay his fellow aspirant to secure his position as a blood angel, his compassion proved his morals to be pure. Enduring the winnowing of weariness for 3 solar days as he remained awake from his former trials, as slumber threatened to end his vigil, the Sanguinor would once again visit Luis Dante. Managing to succeed in the final test of his character, Luis declared the name to which he would be known by his kin in deference to his father's bloodline, Dante. Drinking the gene seed synthesized blood of Sanguinius, Dante underwent his year-long transformation as his body writhed in a comatose state within a sarcophagus. His body undergoing drastic physical changes as he cried out the names of fallen primarchs, fell demons, and their malevolent benefactors, Dante emerged from his metamorphosis in a form alien to his senses. His sanctified sarcophagus, said to have had its heavy lid lifted during his struggle, none had ever exhibited such torment and lived during the many storied observations of such aspirants' transformations. Reborn in the image of a true son of the angel, his dense muscle tissues and implanted organs had turned Luis into a weapon of the Emperor and guardian of humanity. Upholding the 5 angelic graces consisting of honor, humility, mercy, restraint, and forgiveness, Dante began to uphold the creed of his chapter with his continued service. Incorporating the 5 warrior virtues of strength, savagery, abandon, rage, and detachment to mirror his nobler traits, Dante quickly ascended to the rank of Brother Sergeant as he began his service to his chapter. Promoted to the rank of Captain during 753.M40, only 6 years shy of his 3rd century of life, Dante would soon watch the most senior leaders of his kin perish. The Callias insurrection incited rebellion against the Imperium, and so it was that the Angels of Death brought retribution to the Callias subsector. The Angels Numinous quelled the rebellion, yet in the wake of such blatant heresy committed by its populace, whilst in league with warbands of traitor space marines, the Angels Numinous were driven back. Aiding their brother chapter in battle, the Blood Angels dispatched 3 companies to the fray, including Captain Dante, at the head of his 5th company. The conflict protracted as more chapters entered the fray to cleanse the heresy from Callias. Yet as the years of war raged on, the full might of the Blood Angels would be brought to bear. Slaying millions in their wake, the Blood Angels for their retribution suffered immense casualties until reinforcement from the Imperial Guard and other Space Marine chapters were committed to ending the insurrection. Withdrawing from the conflict as they tended to their wounds, once regrouped, the Demon Blaze led by Dante destroyed numerous Chaos Capital class vessels, yet with the war concluded, observed their broken ranks. Less than 200 Astartes remained of the chapter, losses so great that only their devastation from the 7th Black Crusade of Abaddon the Despoiler compared. The chapter council had perished, with Dante standing as the most senior officer of the chapter among his peers of the sanguinary priests and chaplains. Electing Dante as the new chapter master of the Blood Angels, the conclave of the remaining officers reluctantly sanctioned his mastery with no alternatives present. And so it was that the reluctant Lord of Angels was appointed, yet little would he know that his lengthy service as the leader of the Blood Angels had merely begun. While none among the subjects of the Imperium would dare besmirch the legacy and deeds of Commander Dante during the era Indomitus, his early incumbency would be scrutinized heavily by his peers. Dante held the most powerful position within the chapter simply by virtue of being the only man alive to fill the role, yet little would his detractors realize the error of their misgivings. His millennia of service to the chapter, upheld as among the most paragon of examples to follow for all chapter masters of the Adeptus Astartes, the noble ideals and deeds of the Lord of Angels are the stuff of legends. Clad in shining, opulent golden artificer armor in battle, His beatific form, wrought of among the finest artistry of any armorer's craft, is alike to watching a brilliant flame of the Emperor's will soaring above the battlefield. Swiftly darting across war zones by use of his jetpack, and concealing his face behind the death mask of Sanguinius, Dante's likeness, crafted in the image of the great angel, looks down upon his foes with an accusatory stare of hatred. Never removing his death mask in the presence of outsiders to his chapter, Dante allows his true face only to be visible within the fortress monastery of the chapter, the Arx Angelicum, and only to those of his most trusted kin. Wielding the ancient Infernus pistol, Perdition, and the Ex Mortalis in battle, these weapons of immense power, forged prior to and following the Horus Heresy, respectively, have slain countless traitors, Xenos, and heretics. Yet in the quiet moments of the Chapter Master's contemplation, melancholy reflects the heavy toll the millennia of service have wrought. Said to be the oldest Space Marine to currently serve within the Adeptus Astartes by a long margin, Dante has watched the Imperium's gradual decline with his survival of over 1,000 years of service. Even the transhuman forms of the Emperor's angels have limits, and the scars of time have not been kind to the bringer of light. His record of triumph exceeding the deeds of any honor roll among the Angels of Death's many chapters, the facts of his deeds have long been distorted by legends and embellished retellings which have endured past the lifespans of billions of Imperial subjects. Though not as beloved as the Great Wolf of the Vilka Fenrica, Logan Grimnar, due to his wisdom and countless deeds made in the name of the Imperium, Commander Dante is a more distant and unknowable entity. More mythic in nature than a man of flesh and blood, deeds such as his banishment of the exiled son of the Blood God, Scarbrand, at the gates of Pandemonium, is more fable than military record. Triumphant over the Night Lord Legion on the world of Terrion, centuries following their liberation by the Sons of the Great Angel, the world once ravaged by the Sons of the Night Haunter has erected statues of gold and marble to honor Commander Dante as the planet now flourishes as a near paradisal world. Said to have visited more bastions of the Imperium, waged more wars than any commander, and felled more foes than any other than the revered Sons of the Emperor, Dante's legacy has been blurred and twisted beyond all recognition of fact or true account. Aiding the Ultramarines chapter during the scouring of Ultramar of 746.M41, their reinforcement of free battle companies to face the Tyranid invasion would not be forgotten by the scions of Robouite Guilliman. Triumphant during the Second War of Armageddon against the hordes of the Greenskins under the command of their grim prophet, Ghazgul Mag Uruk Fraka, the Blood Angels under the banner of the General of the Archangels have earned much glory. Yet with the era of the 41st millennium drawing to a close, the Golden Seraph of the Blood Angels would face a threat capable of sundering his chapter's legacy. The Cryptus System had long served as a bastion of the Sons of the Great Angel for millennia. Within close proximity to the Baal system, the so-called Krypton Shield stood as the last line of defense against any force wishing to harm the homeworld of the Great Angel and seat of power of the Blood Angels chapter. No force, whether Chaos nor Xenos in nature, had ever breached its defenses until the invasion of Highfleet Leviathan during 998.M41. Sacrificing the shield worlds of the system to stave off the Great Devourer, such was the sheer force of numbers possessed by the Tyranid menace that drastic action would be required to fend off the total annihilation of the Baal system. Rallying every available successor chapter of the Blood Angels to his command, Commander Dante petitioned every able-bodied Astartes who shared their bloodline of Sanguinius to preserve his holy resting site and homeworld of his youth. The Angels in Carmine, Angels Excelsis, Angels Glorious, Angels of Light, Angels Numinous, Angels Penitent, Angels Sanguine, Angels Vermilion, Blood Drinkers, Blood Legion, Blood Swords, Blood Wings, Brothers of Jarad, Brothers of the Red, Burning Blood, Carmine Blades, Charnel Guard, Disciples of Blood, Exsanguinators, Flesh Eaters, Flesh Tearers, Golden Sons, Knights of Blood, Red Knights, Red Wings, Sable Brotherhood, Sanguine Host, and Scions of Sanguinius, all aided in the defense of Baal as a force of over 29,000 Astartes strong. Records indicate that 8 chapters would perish during the onslaught, with over 5 chapter masters slain defending the holy soil of Baal. As the Tyranids consumed the biomass of the fallen and closed in on the ever-dwindling holdouts of the Blood Angels, Dante, as the head of his honor guard, sought to stem the tide of innumerable alien filth in defense of his chapter's fortress monastery. Far distant across the void of space, the Black Legion of Abaddon the Despoiler destroyed the bastion of humanity, Cadia, and with its death the Eye of Terror expanded into the Great Rift, the Cicatrix Maledictum. Demons spewed from the Immaterium, led by the Bloodthirster of Khorne, Kabanda, emboldened by the birth of the Great Rift, and bloodshed unleashed upon Baal. The galaxy was torn asunder, as soon after, at the height of the battle, Commander Dante incurred a grievous wound. Dueling a fell swarmlord, Dante's martial skill and battle experience would be diminished by his aged body, and though he would be victorious, Dante lay broken. Yet in the Blood Angels' hour of direst need, a beacon of hope descended from the heavens. Robouite Guilliman, Primarch of the Ultramarines and the returned avenging son of the Emperor, unleashed the fury of his vast Indomitas crusade against the Tyranids and forces of Chaos. The Baal system was saved, and despite the ruination and desecration at the hands of the forces of Highfleet Leviathan, the Blood Angels endured. The Lord of Ultramar met with Commander Dante, and following his recovery from the intense siege, Dante saw to the restoration of his chapter. Reinforced by Primaris Space Marines, bequeathed by the Avenging Sun, the Lord of Angels graciously accepted such potent warriors into the ranks of his chapter, and those of their successor kin. Yet the scars inflicted from the devastation of Baal had cut deep, and as Dante assumed the title of Lord Commander of the newly formed Imperium Nihilus, his wearied body began to fail. Dante had suffered so much, yet above all, seen so many virtuous souls under his charge sacrifice themselves to preserve the legacy of his chapter. Among the ashes of the devastation of Baal, Dante had seen a vision of his Primarch, Sanguinius, as the promise of peace and eternal rest called to his broken and weary body. Yet in the embrace of the great angel, the vision of his liege had ordered him to live. His duty had exceeded any warrior of the Adeptus Astartes history. He had killed millions of the servants of foul gods and malevolent Xenos. He had staved off the extinction of his chapter time and again, aided his allies on innumerable war zones, and fought in the name of the great angel, yet Sanguinius forbade him to rest. His duty was not done. Reconciling his vision with records within the scrolls of Sanguinius, his Primarch's writings told of a time wherein a golden warrior stood between the Emperor of Mankind and his destruction. Perhaps this figure was the Lord of Angels, laying down his life to preserve the Master of Mankind during the Imperium's most perilous hour. Yet what good was an old man, long past his prime? His injury at the hands of the Swarmlord had drained him of much of his diminished strength, and his chapter had suffered the greatest calamity in their history. Though in the hour of their darkest days, Lord Commander Dante had witnessed the return of a Primarch, the Lord Guilliman, and with his resurgence, a spark of hope had inspired renewed devotion in the ranks of the Astartes. The Great Rift had made the ruinous powers stronger than ever, and the splinter of Highfleet Leviathan was surely only the beginning of their continued slaughter across the stars. No, Luis Dante had never faltered in his defense of humanity. Undertaking the dangerous procedure of the Rubicon Primaris with the arrival of the Adepts of Mars from the Indomitus Crusade, though many within his own chapter believed his body to be too worn to endure the surgeries, Dante once again proved too stubborn to die. Stronger than ever before, and reinvigorated with purpose in the wake of the return of the Lord of Ultramar, Dante would never dare to dream that his path would cross another of the returned Sons of the Emperor. During the Arcs of Omen campaign, the Blood Angels stood defiant against the resurgent traitor legion, the World Eaters, and their rabid demon Primarch, Angron. Unable to best the Lord of Red Sands in combat, the Blood Angels retreated from the fray as Dante's wounds incurred from the Champion of Khorne threatened to once again end his service. Yet once more, a stalwart legend of yore took up arms to face the darkness. After 10 millennia of slumber, Lion L. Jonson, Primarch of the Dark Angels, took to the field and slew his traitorous brother upon his former homeworld of Caliban. The planet now known as Wormwood, the Lion's great duel against Angron would be chronicled as legend among the Imperium as he banished his fallen kin back into the roiling tides of the warp. Recovering from his battle against the Red Angel, Dante now understands the stakes of the ever-corroding galaxy. Legends of old return to the fray, and ancient horrors attempt to cast down the champions of the Imperium and dethrone its emperor. Sanguinius is gone, yet his spirit remains within the heart of Luis Dante, and with the Angel's stalwart brothers returned once more, the end of the Dark Imperium has begun in earnest. Though whether it shall end in ruination or glorious resurgence is at the hands of those that face the darkness. And Luis Dante, Lord Commander of Imperium Nihilus, shall not betray his oath to his Primarch, nor duty to humanity.
There is always beauty in the depths of ugliness, even in the depths of defeat, said Dante. Your song raises us all above this realm of earthly flesh, for we are angels and warriors in equal part. Our devotion to our Emperor and our Gene Father is a paragon to which the citizens of the Imperium have long aspired. Now we stand upon the brink of death, this will not change. I say, let us not go into the long silences of history, but stride forward into legend. If the tyrannies remained without guidance, we might survive here, behind the walls of the Heaven-Ward Redoubt. But they reorganize. The hive mind is disrupted no longer. Our librarians report the shadow falls once more. It is weak, but it grows stronger with every passing minute, coalescing around one potent nexus. If this is allowed to continue, the tyrannies will become of one mind again, and they shall attack without mercy, and we will perish here, within these walls. We have no notice of the fleet. The void is awash with the energies of the warp. If we strike down their leader, we may deal the swarm one fatal death blow, and save the world beyond Baal. In this way, we will win victory of sorts. We will most likely die in the attempt. Millions of them remain, scant thousands of us. If we stay behind these walls, they will overwhelm the last of our defenses in a few days. This is the only way. The shadow in the warp is a many-headed monster, more ferocious than the Hydra of ancient tales, for it has a billion times a billion heads, and all must be severed before it will die. We have the blades. We have the will. Let us carve the skulls of this creature. Are we not the sons of the great angel? Are we not the most blessed of all the Adeptus Astartes? Our Primarch was among the first to die, but he lives eternally in our beings. The meat and blood of our bodies are his host. For 10,000 years we have protected his legacy within the fortress of our bodies.
Dante bows his head here.
That time is at an end. We are all death company now. The sarcophagi lie shattered, their occupants devoured. Now future upon Baal has died with them. The chapter is finished here, but it is not yet dead. Our bloodline may survive in the gene seed of our brothers elsewhere in the galaxy. It may not. This question of survival is no longer ours to contemplate. Divert your gaze from the future and think of the present, of now, of what we might accomplish in these next glorious hours. For if we must go into the darkness of extinction, Let us do so with our swords in our hands and the wrath of Sanguinius in our grasp. When the tides of the battle reach other worlds, let them lift up their guns and say, we shall not fall. We shall not die meekly. Through battle, we remember and honor the sons of Baal. Who will say I? Who will raise his sword with mine? Who will bring burnished steel and wrathful sword to the slaughter and let red ruin flow? Who will die in remembering our Lord? Our flesh may be devoured, but they cannot touch our souls. We are the blessed of the Emperor's warriors. The soul of our Lord lives in the minds and hearts of every one of us. We, the red-clad, the blood-hungry. We, the wrathful and the pure. We, the sons of Sanguinius, most noble and glorious of all the Primarchs. We hold more than his memories in our hearts and minds. The great angel will not lurk here, waiting for his end. He will strike out, seeking to destroy the leader of his enemies, as he did when he confronted his brother Horus. Such a choice is now ours, as it was our father's. If we do this, we shall all surely perish, but Baal may yet escape and play host to Space Marines still. You and I will not be among them, but the name of the Blood Angels and a score of other chapters who fought with us here will yet be known across the galaxy. For millennia, I have worn this mask so long that mortal humans of 1,000 worlds equate Dante with Sanguinius. One has become the other. I have no need of a mask any longer. I need not wear our father's face. He is in here, in my heart. I reveal my face to you, long hidden for shame of the weakness age reveals. I shall wear this mask when I fight in honor of our Lord. But I go into the final battle, not as a poor facsimile of our father, but as Commander Louis Dante, son of Baal, son of the great angel, whose living body is the host of the Primarch. What say you, warriors of Baal?
He said in a ferocious whisper that rose in volume and power.
That we let slip the red durst one final time and fly upon the wings of wrath with our Lord unto battle. I commend you all, O ye mighty, to the protection of the great angel. For the Emperor, for Sanguinius, there is no beauty to be had from life. So let us then seek a beautiful death.
A beautiful death for the Emperor, for Sanguinius,
the doomed angels shouted. Their voices shook the ruins of the Basilica Sanguinarum.
Then we march. All of us who bear the blood, Chaplain O'Daniel, summon the Amerian Guard. Open the gates of the Tower of Amerio. And let the damned march with the damned.
This has been a tale of the Great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. The Lord Commander of Imperium Nihilus is burdened with duty beyond any of his peers. Ancient beyond measure and revered as the embodiment of the Great Angel's will, Dante accepts his burden of duty as legends of old return to face the darkness in the bleakest of eras. Yet no matter the devastation, no matter the rivers of blood shed in the name of the Emperor, Dante stands. For alike to his example, you must never surrender to encircling darkness, for you are a beacon of hope to those who need you. So stand alike to the Lord of Angels.